As we prepare ourselves to come to Jesus' table of love this morning, you might have noticed that much of the language being used seems to resonate of that of Palm Sunday. The language of Palm Sunday is language of special celebration. It is the day that we call the triumphal entry, a description set aside for a king. That day's celebration is the start of a chain of events that ends not in triumph, but in disgrace and defeat come 5 days later. It is a part of what makes this Passover meal so important for those of us who follow Christ. In Matthew 21, we read about Jesus riding into town on a young donkey, and the streets are lined with followers of Jesus, waving palm branches, saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." These, of course, attracted attention to those who saw Jesus as a threat to Jerusalem and to their way of life. Hosanna has become a word of praise over the centuries. But the original Hebrew meaning of that word is save or rescue. So if we were to change the words that the crowd was actually saying, this is what we would hear. The Son of David who saves, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The one who is highest in heaven is the rescuer. When you add this with the tradition of how a king is greeted into the city by his subjects, riding on a horse along streets filled with waving palm branches, you can see why Caiaphas and Pilate were concerned about Jesus and his agenda. The whole understanding of the word Messiah in Hebrew was the king who saves his people from a foreign power, making Israel safe to live under its own rule. But this is not the teaching that Jesus gave in his Sermon on the Mount. For his teaching of the Beatitudes does not speak of peace through force, but rather through having a poor spirit, able to give mercy, and of being a peacemaker. In Jesus' last beatitude, he says, "Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." In this morning's dramatic reading, are we clapping for the wrong God? There is a piece that says, today we are the crowd screaming, "He's an agitator," at those who are speaking up for humane treatment of non-documented immigrants. Today we are the crowd screaming, "He's a revolutionary," to those who promote a message of equal distribution of resources for all, that there is enough for everyone. Today we are the crowd screaming, "He tells them to love God, yet he breaks the Sabbath laws." Oh, how dare the pastor and the worship team want to change the way that we worship, bringing in modern songs and plays and spiritual dance and making worship look like a theater production. Today we are the crowd screaming, "He tells them to do good, yet he dines with sinners." Look over there, Edith. See that woman sitting over there? She's a transgender. And that couple that's behind us, they're living together. They're not even married. that college student over on the left side of us, he dyes his hair the most obnoxiously and weird colors I've ever seen. I'm not sure I really feel comfortable having visitors think that we accept those kinds of people. In the second part of the ninth beatitude, Jesus says, "Rejoice and be glad when these negative things happen to you because of me. Because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." We in the United States have been greatly blessed by God through a modern prophet by the name of Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. And his courage to speak up and out about justice for people of color in a society of white privilege. In the 1960s, up to date have been the most turbulent decade that I can recall that I have lived through. But life changed dramatically because of Dr. King's prophetic voice. As the followers of Dr. King readied to march in Selma, Mississippi in 1965, he said this to them: "I can't promise you that you won't get beaten. I can't promise you that it won't get your home bombed. I can't promise you that it won't, that you won't get scarred up a bit. But you must stand up for what is right. If you haven't discovered something that is worth dying for, you haven't found anything worth living for." Because of the courage of many who stood up against racism in the 1960s, laws changed in favor of equality. When you think about Jesus telling us that the kingdom of God is among us, and when you can understand what he meant then in the ninth beatitude, just by looking what we went through in the civil rights movement. Because the kingdom of God is present. It's not someplace out in the future. It's what we're making it today. I read a story about a young man who started his life out being raised in a cult community farm. Being raised to understand a God of abundant punishment and stingy in love. After his mother divorced his father, the family moved away from that community to live with his maternal grandparents, a place of safety for him, and where he was able to attend churches that taught another story about God with respect to abundant love and slow to anger. During his teen years, he came out as being gay. With the support of his grandmother, he realized that he could pursue his call into ministry as a gay individual and currently works with an organization called Love Makes a Family, which helps educate congregations about human sexuality. His take on the ninth beatitude, he says, is this: "I know that there is much hatred spewed about gay people. I've heard it all my life. But I don't feel that I am persecuted because I am really caught up in the joy of knowing that there is a God who loves me. I hear, rejoice and be glad." And when I hear this beatitude, and I hear that your reward is great with God, and so I don't hear all of that cursing. Ann Sutherland Howard writes, "Most of us church people, I include myself, dare to do the possible. We do what's in our sight, what doesn't cost too much, And what we know we can manage. That kind of sounds like us. We rely on our own strength. But God calls us saying, dare to do the impossible. God calls us to step out, to be advocates for those who don't have voices. Sometimes I think we need to be more like the prophets of the Bible, to set aside our own self-interests, to set aside our desire for security and stability, to set all that aside to make room for God's disruptive justice. Today we celebrate Communion, the feast of love and inclusion. But where will we be when the angry voices of Good Friday rise up against Jesus' teachings that all are worthy to live and participate in God's kingdom? Are we willing to stand up against the insults, the bad things that come with standing up for justice, mercy, and peacemaking? We're eager to join Jesus at the table this morning, but are we wanting to follow a Jesus that the crowd in Jerusalem was expecting? The Messiah that will save us from all of the bad people? Or are we willing to follow the Jesus of the Beatitudes, where mercy, forgiveness, justice, and peacemaking are used to create God's kingdom here on earth? In the Beatitudes, old barriers lose their power and old wounds can lose their sting. Through the Beatitudes, we are called to be revolutionaries to the world. We become the agitators of what is not right. We can speak the true word of love and dine with sinners, and most of all, forgive when we have been wrong. By living a beatitude-filled life, we are on that donkey with Jesus, riding into the cross that tries to deny God's power in a world that thinks it holds the power. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. Amen.
Amen.